One of the older debates among computer scientists and programmers is whether it's better to write important code with an explicit resource control language like C or C++, or with a garbage collected language such as Java or C#. In the last 15 years, almost all of the important services and code that I've seen written have been written in a garbage collected language, either C# or Java. Is this the right thing to do? And if not, why not? Hi, I'm John Miller, the Deliberate Engineer. I've been programming for 40 years, and I spent 30 years working in industry in a variety of companies, including Microsoft, Amazon, and Google. I helped develop operating systems, applications used by millions of people, cloud services, and even cloud infrastructure that cloud services are built upon. Before we get started, I'd like to spend a little time talking about what it means for a language to be garbage collected in practical terms. When I first started writing code in C and C++ 30 years ago, the programmer had complete control over when resources were allocated and deallocated and how this was done. They had to make explicit calls. They could still do multi-threaded and multi-process programming and synchronize between those things, but all of this was typically done explicitly and manually by the programmer. This degree of control was especially important for operating systems development. You wanted to be able to make a system that could deal with all sorts of corner cases, out of memory, out of disk, disk not functioning well, network down, network slow, have it be able to limp along while that condition persisted, and then be able to recover and keep running once resources were available again. The goal of the operating system was to never go down. This degree of control allows a programmer to have more direct control and make the system more deterministic than it would be if it was doing things on its own. This is especially critical for operating systems and critical real-time systems. It also takes a great degree of skill and a lot of attention to detail on the part of the programmer. Resources and resource leaks are one of the most common sources of bugs in these types of systems. And in fact, in the systems that I worked on, such as operating systems, the code that you wrote to handle these out-of-resource conditions actually wound up being the majority of the code. Let's say that I have a small routine that needs to allocate two different objects and then call a helper routine that'll take those two objects, keep one of them and add it to a list, and then return the other one and let it be done with it whatever the caller wants to. Writing this sort of code in a non-garbage collected language actually requires a lot of different cases. You have to create the first object. If it fails, you return a failure case. Then you have to create the second object. If that fails, you have to free the first object that was allocated. Then let's say that you've got both of your objects created successfully. Now you call the utility function. If the utility function works, you need to free the object that wasn't actually kept and taken over by that function, and you need to leave the other one alone. But if that call failed, you need to free both of those objects. So there's a lot of different cases there that have to do with tracking the lifetime and the ownership of objects. And this is very much a function of working in an explicit resource tracking system like C++ or C. Now, let's take a look at that same operation written in a garbage collected language like Java or C#. Here you see we just have three lines of code. The first is to allocate the first object, the second to allocate the second object, and then finally to call the helper function that will do whatever it needs to. References to these different objects are automatically tracked by the runtime for the programming language. You don't have to do anything for it. So if you exit that routine, having created all these objects, it'll only free the ones that aren't being used still. When I say the runtime will free those objects, what I mean is that there's something called garbage collection that runs periodically, opportunistically. Sometimes it'll run only when the allocator or other relevant functions are called. Other times it'll run on a background thread. And at that point, it'll take a look at all of the allocations and all the objects that it has in memory, and for some subset of those, figure out whether they have references or not. If there's nothing pointing to that object, it's considered an orphan object and safe to clean up, and so it gets garbage collected, and the allocation subsystem gets control of that physical memory back, or that virtual memory, whichever it is. Again, those unreferenced items are effectively garbage. They're not needed by the system. And so we call it garbage collection when we hunt around for unreferenced objects that can be freed and reclaimed. As a programmer, I can tell you it's wonderful to work in a garbage collected system for the most part. You don't have to worry about all these extra conditions and cases of, oh, did I fail allocating one of my objects? Do I have to free other objects because of it? You don't have to track all those references. It all just takes care of itself. This lets you write code much faster. It lets you write code that has less cyclosomatic complexity. And so this, in turn, lets you test it easier. So all those are great things. As you probably know by now, there's nothing that you get for free. So what's the downside of using a garbage collected language? In this case, the downside is what we talked about earlier, control. By using a garbage collected language, you typically give up control of when that garbage collection is done and how long it takes. In most cases, this doesn't matter. You're doing something that can tolerate a millisecond delay, and a millisecond is all it takes for garbage collection. However, in some cases, garbage collection has to deal with a very large number of objects. For example, let's say that you have a program that's reading in a huge file or a continuous file stream, line by line, and it's allocating an object for every single word on every single line. Very quickly, you wind up with a lot of objects that were initially used and then aren't needed anymore. If there's not an opportunity to clean that up, if the system's too busy, then the amount of garbage that has to be looked through and the number of references that have to be looked through keeps growing and growing and growing. Suddenly, instead of having a system where you control when it pauses and what it's doing, you have a garbage collection system that sooner or later is going to have to take a pause, lock parts of the memory heap, and go through it looking for garbage to reclaim resources. Now, in bad cases, I've seen this take more than a minute. That's a long time for an important service to be paused and to be out of the control of the person who wrote the program. One of the worst things that can happen in a garbage collected system is that the garbage collector and the memory heap fall so far behind that they can't recover from the number of resources that have been allocated. They just wind up hanging, or worse, throwing exceptions, an out-of-memory error, despite there being lots of resources that could be freed by garbage collection, because it just can't free them quickly enough. This is absolutely something that happens. I've had to deal with it operationally in services and in applications, and when it does happen, it sucks. So why doesn't this happen with C and C++? The answer is it's relying on the programmer to explicitly know the lifetimes of the objects and to take care of freeing them. When the system starts running low on memory, for example, it gets a notification that it can't allocate new objects, the programmer has control over deciding what should be freed, where, when, and how. They likewise have that same degree of control over allocation of objects. So, for example, they can just say, oh, well, I didn't really need that object, where it's a little more difficult and a little more resource intensive to do that in managed languages or in garbage collected languages, because you wind up throwing an exception and then you have to create objects to deal with that exception. It can be a really unpleasant situation if you're out of memory. That's why lots of garbage collected languages, when they run out of memory, they just try and save whatever state they can and then barf and restart. Overall, a correctly written program in C or C++ will be faster and less resource hungry than a language written in C# or Java or some other garbage collected language. So why isn't everything written in C and C++? The first reason is because it's a lot harder to write in these explicit resource control languages. As you heard me mentioning earlier, the complexity of the program becomes much higher. There's all sorts of error cases that have to be handled by the program, which means some of them will be missed and there's going to be more bugs. Also, the world is a lot different than it was 10 or 20 or 30 years ago. And so it's relatively rare that we have an environment that is significantly resource constrained. It can still happen, but more typically you'll have something like a light bulb that still has a gigabyte of RAM, and there's no way it's going to run out of memory doing the sorts of things it does. So it winds up being much less of an issue. Today, a lot of the systems that are being created scale up by being distributed systems. In other words, they have lots of instances of each type of program running. What this means is the system has to be built in a way that can tolerate new instances coming up and joining the distributed system, instances leaving the distributed system with and without warning, and all kinds of other error conditions. As long as the system can cope with that, it can cope with an instance that dies because it did an out-of-memory error in Java, or kills itself because it realizes it's taking too long in garbage collection. This is just another error case for the distributed system, and typically the systems can handle it well. So the cost of using a garbage collected language in terms of making the system more reliable doesn't really show for the end application of that system. Summing things up, C and C++ and other explicit resource management systems tend to be less resource hungry and more reliable than the garbage collected systems that are built in Java and C#. However, they're also more likely to have bugs. They take twice as long to write things in, literally, typically twice as long to write applications in. It's also a little harder to find people who are familiar with those systems. Now, garbage collected systems, on the other hand, the code is much simpler, much faster to write, and typically you're running in a resource-rich environment or a distributed environment where the problems you would normally bump into just aren't that significant with the garbage collected code. So why not use code that's easier to write, that's less problematic to test, and that more people know how to write code in, rather than using something that gives you explicit control but makes you pay through the nose for it? I know this is a relatively controversial subject, and so I'm pretty interested to hear what you have to say, especially if you're a more experienced developer who's worked both in the explicit resource control languages and in garbage collected languages. Do you think that I gave a fair comparison between these things? What's your personal experience? Do you agree or disagree with the conclusions? Do you have any stories of your own to share that illustrate why one way or the other might be better? Please leave a comment down below. I'd love to hear what you think. Thanks for watching to the end of the video, and keep on pushing forward. Hi, this is John. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please think about subscribing so you get notified of my future videos. Also, if you are interested, you might want to check out the video I have linked here. Thanks, and keep on pushing forward.